This is lecture 11 in engineering mechanics. Today we will continue our discussion on theorem of three forces and then we will solve problems. So what is the theorem of theorem of three forces? So it tells you about the conditions for equilibrium of three non-parallel forces. Three non-parallel forces are to be in equilibrium, then they must be in same plane, they must intersect at a point, and their free vectors must form a closed polygon or closed triangle. So that is the theorem of three forces. As we said, it is very useful in finding the reactions. Now last class we have seen by one example where this is useful in finding the reactions. Now we will take continue our discussions on that. We will take an example like this, which you can imagine to be a seesaw. So some member like this, a board or a prismatic bar which is hinged at the center. So you can consider this, you would have seen such arrangement in playground, which is a seesaw. Okay, so the people play around and there will be seats here, so you can just rock this. So in a seesaw, it's a board. The board is attached in the center, it is supported in the center using a device or this thing called it is a hinge, or you can say it is hinged. So this element is a hinge, or to be more technical, we can call it as a revolute joint, which permits the rotation only. That is the revolute joints. The machine elements like bearings do that job. Okay, that's a revolute joint. You can see such revolute joints, you know, like this in your doors and windows. You have these devices too. These are the one which permits your door or window only to rotate. So no other motion is possible, only it can rotate. So it's a revolute joint. So this you call it as a door hinge. You can also use kind of rivets that can make up this. Okay, so essentially there will be a hole, cylindrical hole, and there will be a cylindrical shaft in it or a pin in it. So that makes this arrangement. So that is a cylindrical hole and a cylindrical member, that is a shaft inside that makes a hinge, right? So this seesaw, it is in equilibrium by application of the weight of the people who are sitting. But here this is in equilibrium by application of two forces, P and Q. So it need not be a seesaw, it can be anything. It's a center, it is hinged. So a force is applied in one direction, other force is applied in another direction. This is found to be in equilibrium. This is not moving with respect to time. This is in equilibrium. Now, how to go about? What is the kind of reaction you will get from the hinge? What is the direction of the reaction from the hinge? Yeah? As per the reactions from the support, we have so far discussed about the supports which has no friction between them. So we have seen the interaction between a ball or roller with a flat surface. If they are frictionless, then the forces will be normal to it. That's what that's a kind of support we have seen. But this is a hinged support. What kind of reaction it will give? Whether it will be normal, it will be passing through the center or else. So there we need some more understanding about the nature of the hinge, what kind of forces are acting on it. Okay, so now I will zoom this part, a hinge. How would you zoom it? How this would look like? Okay, it is, there is a hole. Okay, so this hole is one which is attached with your seesaw. This hole is the in the seesaw. Then you have a pin which is sitting inside. So that pin invariably, if you look at the size of the pin and the hole, just to say using common sense, what could be the size of the pin, the diameter of the pin that should be inserted in the hole? It should be greater, or it should be less, or it should be equal. Yes, if it is, if the diameter of the pin that you want to insert is greater, it may not, you can force it, you can hammer it and then push it through, but you cannot move it. Okay, so you have a different situation where you have this arrangement which will not permit motion, but here motion is permitted. So how you are, the wheels of the train, that is wheels of the train are attached to the shaft. Train wheels are there, right? Then there are shafts. So how the wheels of the train is attached with the shaft? So if you say this is your train wheel and you have a shaft at the center, how it is attached? They are not supposed to permit the shaft. You have other wheel, right, parallel to it, though the wheel is, there should not be any relative motion between these two. In this case, it is attached by oversizing the shaft. Then what I do is, I use greater pressure to insert it forcibly, or I heat the wheel so that it expands, then put the shaft inside, allow it to cool, it will shrink. So this type of fit is called a press fit. The fitting between the shaft and the hole and the shaft is done by pressing. The shaft size is greater, it is called a press fit, or it comes under the interference fit category. Okay, we are not talking about that. We are talking about the one which will permit motion. So in that case, whether the size can be equal or it should be less, or it will be less. Ideally speaking, if it is equal, it is fine. But it is very difficult to match, find an exact size of a pin for this hole. So there will always be a clearance. This clearance is also beneficially used to put your lubrication. Okay, this nature of the joint, the diameter of the pin will be less than the diameter of the hole, so that you can easily insert it without pressure, and the small clearance which is there is beneficially used for retaining your lubrication. You put lubrication, it is easy for you to move it. Now what will be that, you know, the gap will be, it should not be too large. The gap we are talking about is less than the size of the human hair. Okay, less than the size of the human hair. We are very, very thin, very small clearances. If it is too large a clearance, you know, it will be shaking on this side. It is supposed to only allow a rotary motion, but it will permit the shaky motion. It will shake. But for the, so the clearances will be very, very small. But for the, for understanding or visualization, we exaggerate that clearance. Definitely this much clearance will not be there. So we will say that there is a shaft inside this. This is an exaggerated clearance. Because I also draw something, you know, you will not be able to appreciate there is a clearance at all. So the shaft will invariably will be smaller than the hole. That means the when these two are, there is a kind of force interaction between them, the interaction will not happen throughout its surface. So only part of this surface will be in interaction, not the entire surface area, but it will be only a region of this here, part of this profile only will be in contact. So because here you have a clearance, when there is a clearance, no force interaction can happen. Okay, now what is the nature of the force interaction? Do you appreciate that there is a small clearance will be there in all kind of pin joint? Even this, there is a clearance. In here, there is a clearance. But the better quality joints are the one which has a very low clearance. Not between one joint, but if I make hundreds of joints, all the hundred joints are able to have same kind of a clearance, that I, my manufacturing process, my design and this thing is better. Okay, so now here there will be a clearance and interaction will happen only in the part of the pin and hole. So what kind of a nature of the forces? If you assume this pin is very smooth or the hole is also smooth, then you can say there is a friction is absent, the friction is negligible. In that case, you will have the forces, interaction of the forces will be like this, radial, normal to the surface at every point. At every point, it will be normal to the surface. That means what? It is, it is a this is be radially acting. So if you look at this, this is not a single force. This is going to be the forces distributed over the surface area. So this is a distributed force. So we have chapter on distributed forces, but later. Now these distributed forces, whether we can sum up these distributed forces so that it can be a single force. Okay, for that let us see this in detail further. I am drawing this little larger, this hole, and you have this shaft is there. Shaft or pin is here, like this. So I am, this is my center. If there is a force, see, at radial force is acting like this. I take two of these forces which are acting at same angle for my consideration. Same angle means, suppose I have from here some normal direction, same angle. I take two of them, then resolve them into two components. So one rectangular components like this, I resolve them. Here also I resolve. So these two components, what will happen, you can see that these two horizontal components are the components which are cancelled out. They will be equal in magnitude and they will cancel out. So what you will be left out, what you will be having is only the forces in this direction. Similarly, if I take other two components here which lie in the same angular orientation, if you resolve them also, you will see that these are, you know, their components in the horizontal direction will be cancelled out only in this direction, is reinforced or added. So if you see, even though you have a distributed forces like this, all of them, their component on this directions are cancelled out, only in one direction they are reinforced. So in that direction you will have a net force acting. So if you say this is a reaction, you can say net reaction will be acting like this. So you can find that that this force is passing through the center also. Okay, so this is the kind of understanding we should develop when it comes to the revolute joint. Okay, if I have a revolute joint, I can hold one of this, I can hold the other one and try to apply force. What kind of interaction here you will get is, you know, it will develop a force in a particular direction. Okay, it will develop a force in a particular direction passing through the center of that the pin. Yeah, any doubt? Yes.
Two circles must have only one point of contact.
No, definitely not a one point of contact. It will be over area. Okay. If you say clearance, you can think of the whole thing is a very idealistic and a very rigid thing. You can say it is a point of contact. Geometrically, it is one point of contact, but it is not going to be like that. Definitely, it is not going to be like that. There will be a contact over a area only, but that area still, if you idealize it, as you say, the geometrically the point where it would have in contact, if the whole thing is rigid, this will be the case. Okay, any other doubts? So whenever you have a hinged joint, the hinged joint can give you the force, single force passing through the center. But what is the direction of the force? At what direction it is capable of giving the reaction? There is a pin and this thing. In what direction it is capable of giving the reaction? It is capable of giving the reaction in all the directions, in any direction possible. For example, the same case, I have this hole and the contact is like this. Okay. So you have a clearance here, the contact is on this side, then the force will be, net force will be, the net reaction from this will come from here, this side. So the pin, the clearance is, you know, the adjusted, the contact will establish in the side where you, the net reaction is acting. Okay, so if you are moving this in this direction, the shaft, the pin will move, come in contact with here, and the reaction will come this side. So in all the 360 degrees it is possible to give the reaction. Accordingly, the small clearance is used and the pin will go and contact with that particular side and give you the reaction. Okay, so this is the nature of reaction that you can have. Any doubt? Okay, now if you come back here, I am having a hinge or revolute joint, in this case of a seesaw, and it is capable of giving a force in any direction passing through the center of the revolute joint. Now in this case, how will you determine? Because as I said that the hinge is capable of, the revolute joint is capable of giving the force in any direction. It can give you the force in this direction or this way, this direction or this direction. The reaction can come in any direction. And which direction it comes in this case? To find out that, you can use the theorem of three forces effectively, because here you see that there are two forces already in action. The reaction will be coming from the hinge. And these three forces are non-parallel. Therefore, you can use the theorem of three forces. Now, what you do is, you extend this P, extend the Q, they are intersecting here. And this body is in equilibrium. So, if this is to be in equilibrium, the third force must intersect at the same point here. So, from here to the center of this, you draw a line. That will be the line of action of the reaction. So you can have the reaction. The reaction will be like this. What is it? This is the line of action of the reaction. But whether it will be in this direction, in this direction, that can be found by drawing this, you know, the force polygon. This is P and say this is Q. And this is to be closed. So the reaction, it's like this. Okay, so you can find out like this. This is the direction of the reaction, and from this one you can find out the magnitude of the reactions also. So otherwise it's very difficult for you to proceed, because you should know the nature of the revolute joint itself, and since it is capable of giving the force in any orientation, you can use this theorem of three forces effectively to find out. Any doubts? So you'll be encountering the problems with wherein revolute joints are there, then you have to use this principle. Now we'll take the another example. This is clearly discussed in the book. What is given in the book only, I'm just taking it again, but little more elaborately. Now we have another problem given in the book, another example given in the book. There is a bar like this. You have a bar and one side of it is hinged. One side is hinged, the other side is not hinged. It is placed over a roller. It's placed over a roller. Where we use it? Is it for theoretical problem? Just for the sake of the problem, such things are given? No, they are practically used whenever you want to have a large structures like this to be supported. If I hinge here also, if I have a bridge to be built where the span is about 10 meters or 20 meters like that, and if I hinge it on both sides, and this bridge is subjected to your temperature, environmental temperature fluctuations throughout the season, or from the day and night, so they will expand on contract. So with such a large structure, if it expands or contracts here, it is not permitted in a hinge. What will happen is they will bend itself, so it introducing enormous stresses inside, it may collapse or crack. So if we don't permit the structures to expand or contract for the thermal variations, what will happen is they will ultimately may break, the cracks will form. Okay, you should have some relief. So that's why tiles are normally provided with a small groove, gaps, so that the thermal expansions are accommodated in that. Now here, to accommodate that thermal variation, still to hold, we have a rollers here. Roller supports are there. They are common. So this roller supports, if you say the roller is smooth without friction, then the reaction offered will be, if you say this is point A and this is point B, the reaction from this will be acting at the normal to the contact surface. And suppose I apply a force at an inclined angle P, what will be the reaction here? So in that case, the reaction, the normally, you know, when we first start, what will be the reaction of this A? Because the hinge can give you the reaction at any angle, and its magnitude is also not known, then normally what we do is, we represent like this. This is RA. If you put a wavy sign for this, it represents that it is not the direction is not known. Okay, if the direction is known but magnitude is not known, we will simply draw a line. Okay, so that is given in the book to as a wavy thing to represent that both are not known. Okay, now this direction is known. What is the only direction is known? Because it should be normal. Now what is the direction of this and magnitude of this? So to find out, we can still use the theorem of three forces, because there are only three forces, three non-parallel forces are there. I can draw this, extend this, the reaction, the normal direction. Then extend this P. So they intersect here at a point. Therefore, as per the hinge is concerned, the reaction will pass through the center. Now you connect this, these two points. Okay, so this is the line of action of the reaction here. So this is RA and this is RB. Now whether it is a closed one or what is the direction, you can find out by drawing the force, the triangle. So here the direction is known now for this, then we can draw like this. So this is P, then you can have this RA direction is like this, this is RA, then from here RB is vertical, so this is the direction of RB, you can draw like this, then they are going to intersect at this point. Since it is to be closed, the directions are going to be like this. You can see that RB is in the vertical up direction. Then RA is like this. So your free body diagram can be drawn like this. This is the free body diagram of your of the supported bar. So this is our mu. Yeah.
You are considering three forces, sir. A, B, and RB, sir.
I didn't consider the weight, so you can say P is a component of the weight as well as this. It is a composition of weight and a further force. You can take like that. I will take weight, but not now. Okay? Say for example, weight is there and weight is a known, and you apply another force, these two forces can be combined to form resultant at any other angle. So you can say that is the thing. Okay? Good. So these are the things that you have to consider. Now we will take up one problem and try to go ahead and solve. So our first problem, is at page 38. Page 38, 1. So this is in the engineering mechanics. By Timoshenko, and Young, 4th edition. So this I have seen that this is available, okay. So now this is a page 38, problem number 1. So I will just draw that, what is the problem given. Then I will read out the problem. So there is a post like this. From this post you have a boat is hanging. So this is a something which is connected to the ship. So this is called a davit. You know, the large ships as lifeboats. So in the event of any untoward situations or emergencies, lifeboats are supposed to be used. You would have seen the Titanic movie where enough number of lifeboats were not there to save everyone, and also the first set of lifeboats were sent without filled up, okay. They are partially filled up. So that is one of the reason for the cause of a large scale the deaths. Now this length is 7.2 meters and this is 5.4 meters. So there in the lifeboats are supported on the crane like structure. That name of the structure is called a davit. So here the problem is about davit. So this boat will have a kind of a mechanism, pulley system here. I haven't shown that. So the pulley system is used to lower the boat. I cannot, you know, the lifeboat cannot be thrown. You have to lower the passengers and you have to lower them on the thing, then you have to release the boat. So that kind of a mechanism is there. Now the problem is the weight of the boat is given as, so you can say this point is mentioned as C, this point is mentioned as B, and this point as A. So the weight of the boat is 960 Newton. Okay, let me read the problem. The boat is suspended on two identical davits like ABC, which is pivoted at A. So here we are using the term pivoted. So it is pivoted at A and supported by a guide at B. Determine the reactions RA and RB at the points of support A and B. If the vertical load transmitted to each davit is 960 Newton, friction in the guide at B should be neglected. So here it's not one davit, two of them are there to hold the boat, and the force mentioned here is acting on each davit. Okay, each davit means you can take it directly. Otherwise, if the boat weight is given, taking the uniformity or symmetry, you have to divide that by 2. So here directly it is the force acting on single, each davit is given, so it is 960 newtons, straight away you can take it. Now you have to find out the reactions from these two reactions acting on these two supports, because this davit is acted upon by the weight of this, and the reaction in the bush or guide here in the pivot. Okay, how to go about? Yeah, torque. We don't talk about torque because we
both point A should not rotate.
A should not rotate.
Both point A, this is not, system should not rotate.
Okay.
So there is a perpendicular distance.
About B it can rotate.
Sir?
About B it can rotate. See, this the whole thing is not supposed to rotate, but it is supposed to be in equilibrium. Okay, so as a matter of fact, this davit can rotate about the axis, vertical axis, it can rotate, so slight variations can be accommodated, but it is now in equilibrium, it is in static equilibrium. To keep this in equilibrium, what are the reactions? Now the thing is, like, first you can see how many forces are going to be in this system. On the davit, this member, how many forces are going to be there? One is the weight which is already acting, we know. There will be a reaction from this gate. There will be a reaction from this support. So totally we have 3. So when there are 3 non-parallel forces, we can use the theorem of 3 forces to our advantage. So what we can say is the reactions, all the 3 forces must intersect. So now we have to see closer to the reactions, what kind of reactions you will get from B and C, A. So this is a guide. It's a guide means it is like a revolute joint. So it is simply like a revolute joint, but the axis is vertical, okay? So it is like a revolute joint. So this revolute joint, the statement, problem statement is says that the friction could be neglected. The friction could be neglected. So it has to be radial. The reaction, so this is like your pin that is going to press against the guide, either this way or that other way. So there will be a reaction coming from here that has to be just radial, like this. What about the, you have any doubt? So you have discussed about a pin joint. It is simply like a pin joint, but you are looking the pin joint in the other side. So it has to be, if you look from the top, it has to be radially outside, passing through the center. So that must be like this. Then what about this? So if you zoom this, what is a pivot? So you can have a pivot something like this. This is your davit part, and this is your the ship part or stationary thing which is supporting. It is not a flat one. It is not a flat or a smooth one, and the reaction like this. If this is the kind of the support at point A, and if you assume that it is frictionless, we can immediately say that the reaction will be only in the perpendicular direction, because it is just sitting on the top, on the floor, touching the floor. So there cannot be any reaction elsewhere, only in the normal direction there will be a reaction. But in this case it is not like that. It is given like this. So this can press against this wall, so it can be in the directions, other directions as well, because it is a groove, it will be a conical groove and a conical part of it. If it's a frustum of a cone sitting on another frustum of a cone of the shaft, so their interaction will be, it can give you a force at an angle also. So let me see that in that case, leaving the details off, now let me ask you a question. If I use this kind of support here, whether equilibrium is possible? Equilibrium is possible. If you ask a question, then you can see that the reaction from here will be like this, horizontal. So RB will be like this, RA will be normal, they will be intersecting here, and the other forces, no way will pass through that intersecting point, so it cannot be in equilibrium. So that is why they have provided an arrangement, a pivot, where it is possible to give you a reaction at any angle. So now, since we know that it can give at any angle, then we can see, I remove the boat and all that. Now coming to the part of it, this is your weight which is acting downwards, and this is the reaction direction, though intersect here. So obviously the reaction from RA must pass through this if it is to be in equilibrium. You see that it is a simple problem. Unless you understand what is the kind of reactions and what is the nature of the supports, you cannot solve. Okay, so this is your this problem, detail of this problem. Now it is pretty clear. We are going to apply a theorem of three forces and proceed. Okay, so now I will draw this the force polygon. This is going to be W, weight of this. This is your line of action of the RA. Then this is going to be the line of action of RB. So you can construct a triangle like that. It must be closed. So you can say that this is the direction, this is the tail, and this should be the head. It is closed. So this is RA and RB. But only thing is, now we have to know what is the angle at which this RA is. RA is inclined, but what angle? For that, the geometry of this can be used. So you can see that there is a triangle which can be formed by the geometry. This is a height 5.4. So this distance is 7.2. If I say this is alpha, then I can say that tan alpha is equal to 5.4 by 7.2. Therefore, alpha is equal to tan inverse of 5.4 by 7.2, that is 36.86. So that is the angle at which this is going to be. Now we know this angle alpha is 36.86. So you will have this also will be alpha, that is 36.86. From this we can say that the cos alpha is equal to this is RA, so there is no use. Okay, I will, the relation between W and RB, so W by RB is equal to tan alpha, so RB is equal to W by tan alpha. Then you have to find out RA and W, so you can say that sin alpha is equal to W by RA, so therefore RA is equal to W by sin alpha. So from this, you know, if you substitute this W is 960 divided by tan 36.86, that is going to give you 1280.4 Newton. Similarly, this RA is going to be 960 by sine 36.86, that is going to be 1600 Newton. It matches with the answers given in the book, so no issue. Okay, so this is so you have any doubts? So like that we can take up few more problems so that we can understand the application of this thing. We also have to take up few problems which uses the projection method, because we have covered a projection method and the theorem of three forces. So this class we will stop.